Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is Pastor Raziel McFall, citizen of the Kingdom of God and ambassador of Christ. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, "Let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion." My fellow believer, this was God's primary motivation and purpose for creating man. In the beginning, our God gave mankind kingdom and not a religion. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus outlines what should be the priorities of man. Every man should busy himself seeking God's kingdom and his righteousness. If the church is to be delivered from the limitations of this world and begin to experience the victory and abundant life that Jesus came to make available to us, we must become more knowledgeable about the kingdom of God and commit ourselves to walking in his righteousness. As you listen to the following message, it is our prayer that you receive insight into God's kingdom and be delivered from the spirit of religion that has held God's people captive for generations. God bless and strengthen you as you listen to the word of God.
Let the kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him.
Well, as you are no doubt aware, our overall topic continues to be the kingdom of God. We've been showing you by many infallible proofs that the kingdom of God was the priority in the ministry and the life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And because the kingdom was the priority in the ministry and the life of Christ Jesus, it has also become the priority in our lives and in our ministry. As you can also see, our subtopic tonight is Rediscovering the Believer's New Testament Inheritance of the Kingdom of Heaven. Again, our subtopic tonight is Rediscovering the Believer's New Testament Inheritance of the Kingdom of Heaven. And so again, my fellow believer, we say the kingdom of God has come unto you. We appreciate God for your presence, and we're just so excited about sharing this wonderful gospel of the kingdom with you this night. So we just praise God for each and every one of you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, tonight's lesson could be considered a continuation of our message titled Saints of God Exercising Dominion as Possessors of the Kingdom. In that lesson, we demonstrated from the Word of God that as believers, we now possess the kingdom as a result of the completed mission of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, including his death on the cross and the subsequent release of God's Holy Spirit within and upon us. Remember what we said it means to possess the kingdom. Here it is. We said that we now possess the kingdom as the people of God, but what does it mean to possess the kingdom? Well, possessing the kingdom means ownership of the legal and legitimate right, power, and authority to reign or exercise dominion, rulership, and governing influence over a designated territory or domain. And so the saints of God need to know that we now possess the kingdom. I believe that one of the greatest mysteries in the church is a revelation about the kingdom of God, including the fact that as a result of the finished work of Calvary and the subsequent release of God's Holy Spirit, the body of Christ now possesses the kingdom and can manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom right now. We learn that one of the major reasons why we as believers now possess the kingdom is the fact that God primarily works in the earth through representative relationships, and he therefore gave us the kingdom with related rights, privileges, benefits, power, and authority so that we can function as his ambassadors and promote and advance his kingdom agenda here on the earth. God still wants his kingdom to come and his will to be done, and he still wants to work through representative relationships. Again, our God still wants his kingdom to come and his will to be done, and he still wants to work through representative relationships. But there's another simple and fundamental reason why our God and Christ Jesus gave the kingdom to us, the believers, his children. Remember what God said as he decided to make man in the beginning. Here it is. We always come back to this scripture. This is the foundational scripture Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, just the first part, the Bible says, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion." At this time, God was establishing the government for the new section of his domain called planet Earth, which was effectively an outpost or a colony of the kingdom of heaven. Remember, we learned that this word dominion that we have animated here also means kingdom. This means that in the beginning, when God said, let them have dominion, God was also saying, let them have kingdom. But notice we have the words, let them have, animated here. Because God said, let them have, this means that dominion or kingdom was a gift from God to his children. Kingdom was a gift. God said, let them have it. And so this was a gift from God. But remember what Paul the Apostle said about gifts from our God. Paul said here in Romans 11:29, for the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. What exactly does that mean? Well, here's the New King James Version of the same scripture, Romans chapter 11, verse 29. Paul was saying to us, for the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. And so, my fellow believer, because the gifts and calling of God are without repentance or are irrevocable, because we through Christ Jesus were reconciled to God, the gift of dominion or the gift of kingdom was restored and reactivated in our lives. Why? Because God said, let them have this thing called dominion. Let them have this thing called kingdom, because dominion also means kingdom. And so when God said, let them have it, God was effectively giving it to us, and so it became a gift. And so Paul lets us know that the gifts and calling of God are firstly without repentance and then irrevocable, according to the New King James Version of the Bible. We have to remember also that Christ Jesus said a word to us. I believe it's in Luke chapter 19, around verse 10. Jesus said that he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And we know that that word save, being the Greek word sozo, that's S-O-Z-O, also means to recover and to restore. And so Christ Jesus came to recover and restore absolutely everything that Adam and Eve lost in the beginning. And so we know that one of the things that Adam and Eve lost was man's ability to execute and fulfill his dominion mandate or assignment on the earth. And so because God said, let them have dominion, let them have kingdom, this was a gift from our God, and the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. And so this is why God was restoring the gift of dominion, the gift of our ability to fulfill our dominion mandate or assignment to his children, to mankind, as it was in the beginning. Man's ability to fulfill his dominion mandate was also lost in the beginning and was therefore restored as part of Jesus's mission. So remember what we said about Christ Jesus here. We said that Christ Jesus did not just come to die on the cross so that we could escape hell and go to heaven when we die. Again, we reiterate that we praise God for the blessed hope of living with God and Christ throughout all eternity in the New Jerusalem in the age to come when Jesus Christ returns. But the saints of God need to understand that Jesus' primary mission was the restoration and reestablishment of his Father's kingdom on the earth. This is why the first thing that he asked us to pray for, as outlined in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10, was, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." And so as believers, we need to be aware of the fact that Jesus did not just come to die on the cross so that we could escape hell and go to heaven when we die. Jesus came to restore God's kingdom government on the earth and to make sonship in God's family and citizenship in his kingdom immediately available and accessible to all mankind. And by so doing, Jesus also came to restore man's dominion mandate that Adam and Eve lost. Jesus' mission was quite simple, my fellow believer. His mission was recovery of the kingdom through defeat of the devil, redemption and reconciliation of mankind to God, and restoration of man's ability to fulfill his dominion assignment so that God's kingdom or government could be reestablished, promoted, and expanded on the earth. Notice we said that Jesus' mission also included restoration of man's ability to fulfill his dominion assignment so that God's kingdom or his government could be reestablished on the earth. Again, we always remind the people of God that according to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, Jesus came with government upon his shoulder. And so government was Jesus' assignment. It was his work. It was his duty. It was his load and his responsibility. So Jesus came to restore God's kingdom government on the earth that Adam and Eve turned over to the devil. My fellow believer, for generations, because as members of the body of Christ, our focus has primarily been on our redemption and consequent preparation for heaven when we die, we have generally overlooked our immediately accessible, powerful provisions in the scriptures, misunderstood our expected function in the earth, and we have barely scratched the surface of our potential in God and Christ Jesus. I think I need to read that again. For generations, because as members of the body of Christ, our focus has primarily been on our redemption and consequent preparation for heaven when we die, we have generally overlooked our immediately accessible, powerful provisions in the scriptures. We have misunderstood our expected function in the earth as the body of Christ, and we have barely scratched the surface of our potential in God and Christ Jesus. Therefore, if we as believers are going to appropriate or take full advantage of our access to kingdom benefits and resources, we must change the way that we think, including the way that we see ourselves, so that we could be transformed as God requires. In this regard, in his letter to the church at Rome, Paul the Apostle made a connection between the way we think and our disposition, or who we are, and how we are supposed to be functioning. Here's what Paul said to us. This is Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Paul said, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed." How? "By the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Again, we focus on the highlighted portion of this scripture. Paul said, "Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." And so even after we are born again, Paul lets us know that we will not be transformed or truly changed unless and until our minds are renewed. This is why Jesus' initial public declaration was so important. According to Matthew, Jesus began his public ministry by saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." What was the first word of Jesus' public ministry? Well, we have it highlighted and animated here. The first word of Jesus' public ministry was this word, repent. Now, it was no accident that this was the first word of Jesus' public ministry. What exactly is this word repent in this context? Well, the word repent, according to the Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew dictionary, is the Greek word metanoeo. That's metanoeo. This word means to think differently. It means to reconsider, and it means to change the way of thinking. Again, we remind you that this was the first word of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's public ministry. This was the first word of his public ministry because changing the way that we think and ultimately the way we see ourselves and how we function are important keys to improved effectiveness in our lives and the fulfillment of God's will, purpose, and intent for us as it relates to his overall kingdom agenda. In this regard, we want to remind you what the Bible says about you. Well, the Bible says that you are a peculiar treasure unto our God. You are a kingdom of priests. You are an holy nation unto our God. You are born of the Spirit of the King of Heaven. You are a duly authorized and empowered son of God. You are a citizen of the Kingdom of Heaven. You are a possessor of the Kingdom of Heaven. You are also a possessor of all things through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You are an ambassador for Christ and God's kingdom. You are complete or fully supplied or furnished through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You are a chosen generation. You are agents of God and Christ Jesus. You, my fellow believer, are a royal priesthood. You are a peculiar people. You are the people of God. You are a king unto our God, and you are a priest unto our God. Tonight, we have come to introduce you to another feature of your identity in Christ. which will reveal and further reinforce our understanding and revelation of the fact that we now possess the kingdom. Tonight, we've come to remind the people of God that they are heirs. Again, we've come to remind the people of God that we are heirs. Paul the Apostle wrote about this feature of our identity in his letter to the church at Ephesus. Here it is. This is Ephesians chapter 3, verses 4 to 6. We just come tonight to remind the people of God of the fact that we are now heirs according to the word of God. Here's Paul speaking about this feature of our identity in his letter to the Ephesians. This is Ephesians chapter 3, verses 4 to 6. Paul said, "Whereby, when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ." Here it is in verse 5 of Ephesians 3. Paul said, "Which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit." Here it is in verse 6. Paul said that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Paul said that his mission to the Gentiles, or to those who are not direct descendants of Father Abraham, including you and I, was to position us to be fellow heirs or recipients of an inheritance. Here's what Paul said to us through his letter to the Galatians. This is Galatians chapter 3, verse 29. Paul said, "And if ye be Christ, indeed we are Christ now. Christ Jesus owns us. We call him our Lord, and so he owns us." Paul said here that if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And so Paul again here lets us know that we are heirs. Here's Paul again in his letter to the Colossians. This is Colossians chapter 3, verses 23 to 24. Paul said, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, and not unto men." Here it is in verse 24. "Knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ." Paul said that your motivating factor as ye do everything as unto the Lord should be the realization that you will receive an inheritance from our Lord. You know, Peter also lets us know why we were begotten, or why we became sons of God or members of his household or family. This is 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 4. Peter said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Now notice we have the words "hath begotten us" highlighted in this scripture. Whenever you see the word "begotten," we want you to think about sonship. Remember in John 3 and 16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." And so Peter is letting us know, and he's reminding us of our sonship when he speaks about the fact that our God hath begotten us again unto a lively hope. And what exactly has he begotten us to? Well, here's what Peter said to us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Peter said, "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you." And so Peter again lets us know that this is all about us receiving an inheritance. And our God has begotten us, or he's caused us to be his children. He's caused us to be members of his family or his household so that we would qualify for an inheritance. Here's what Paul said to us about this in his letter to the Galatians. This is Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 to 7. Paul said here in verse 1, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all." And so Paul is letting us know that until the heir grows up, he is the same as a servant. Here it is in verses 2 and 3 of Galatians 4. Paul said, "But is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father." He said, "Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world." In verse 4, Paul said, "But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law." And why did God send forth his son? Well, here it is in verse 5. Paul said that God sent Jesus to redeem them that were under the law. And why were we redeemed? That we might receive the adoption of sons. And so Jesus Christ redeemed you, my fellow believer, not just so that you could go to heaven when you die, but so that you could immediately become a son of God. He said that we were redeemed so that we might receive the adoption of sons. Then Paul went on to let us know one of the major benefits of our sonship. Here it is in verse 6 of Galatians 4. Paul said, "And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." And why is it so important for us to experience the adoption of sons and to receive the Spirit of God's Son? Well, here it is in verse 7. Paul said, "Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ." And so Paul is letting us know that it was important for us to experience sonship so that we could transition to the position of an heir and qualify for the inheritance. What's Paul's overall message to us from this passage of Scripture? Well, here it is. Paul is letting us know that believers who do not appreciate and realize that they are heirs will continue to function as servants and not sons, forfeiting their access to rights, privileges, and benefits to which they are entitled. Again, Paul is letting us know that believers who do not appreciate and realize that they are heirs will continue to function as servants and not sons, forfeiting their access to rights, privileges, and benefits to which they are entitled. Here's Paul again connecting sonship to inheritance in his letter to the church at Rome. This is Romans chapter 8, verses 14 to 17. Again, we say we praise God for the opportunity to place the Word of God before your face. We want you to leave this Bible study tonight thinking like you are an heir, and we will let you know what you inherited. This is Romans chapter 8, verses 14 to 17. Paul said, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." Here it is in verse 15 of Romans 8. Paul said, "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, our source and our sustainer." And so notice Paul is also reinforcing our sonship. This is key because sonship is what qualifies us for our inheritance. But Paul continues here in verse 16 of Romans chapter 8. Paul said, "The Spirit himself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God." Then look at what Paul said to us here in verse 17. He said, "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together." You see what Paul said in the highlighted portion of this scripture? He said, "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ." My fellow believer, our adoption to sonship ensures our qualification for the inheritance. Many believers do not realize that we are now heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. But as heirs and joint heirs, the question is, what did we inherit? Now, it's one thing for us to know that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. But if we don't know what we inherited, then what's the benefit or value of being an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ? We will discover this together tonight. We will discover what we inherited. But before we proceed, let's look at John's reinforcement of the fact that we are now duly authorized sons of God. Remember, John said a thing to us here in John chapter 1, verse 12. We need to understand our sonship to know that we now qualify for the inheritance. John said here, "But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." Notice what John said. John said that we received power to become the sons of God. What exactly is this word power that we have animated in this scripture? Well, the word power is the Greek word exousia. That's E-X-O-U-S-I-A. This word means privilege. It means force, capacity, competency, freedom, token of control, delegated influence, authority, jurisdiction, liberty, right, and strength. And so John lets us know that the Lord has given us the privilege, force, capacity, competency, freedom, token of control, delegated influence, authority, jurisdiction, liberty, right, and strength to become the sons of God. my fellow believers, as I was preparing this message, the Lord said, let you know that you are not just sons in name only. You are not just sons in name only, but we now possess all the rights, privileges, and the benefits associated with our sonship. And not only our sonship, but our sonship in the most powerful royal family that ever existed and can ever exist. We are now sons of God, my fellow believer. And John lets us know that we are not just sons in name only. We have received the delegated influence and authority to become the sons of God. And so because we are sons of God, to put this in perspective, God is now our Father. God is now our Father. But here's what King Solomon said about the responsibility of a good father. Here it is. God is our Father. As we set this up for you tonight, Solomon said here in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 22, Solomon said, a good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. We thank God that because we are now sons of God, we qualify for the inheritance. Because God is our Father, in every dispensation, He is seeking to raise up a people of inheritance. Again, because God is our Father, in every dispensation, He's seeking to raise up a people of inheritance. Here's what Moses said to the children of Israel to confirm this. This is Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 20. We're just letting you know that you are a son of God, and therefore you are an heir of God. And because you are an heir of God, you qualify for the inheritance. And we need to know what exactly did we inherit. But here's Moses letting us know that in every generation, our God is looking for a people of inheritance. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 20. Moses said, but the Lord hath taken you and brought you forth out of the iron furnace, even out of Egypt, to be unto him a people of inheritance, as ye are this day. My fellow believer, even as the children of Israel were people of inheritance under the Old Testament, we should be people of inheritance under the New Testament. This is why Jesus' death was so important, my fellow believer, because we are people of inheritance. The Bible teaches that unless and until the testator, or the one who produces the last will and testament, dies, that will and testament has no power, and those designated as heirs cannot gain access to their inheritance. Here's Paul confirming this in his letter to the Hebrews. This is Hebrews chapter 9, verses 13 to 17. Paul said, for if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, here it is in verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Here it is in verse 15 of Hebrews 9. He said, and for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, he said, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Here it is in verse 16. He said, for where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. In addition to the need for release of his blood to cleanse, redeem, and pay the ransom for us, Christ had to die to trigger release of the inheritance or benefits due to members of his household or family based on his will and testament. Notice what Paul said here. Paul said, for where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. And so this is another powerful reason why our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ died. But Paul continued here in verse 17. Paul said, for a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. And so again, we say this is another powerful reason why Christ Jesus had to die. Because you are now a son of God, because you are now a child of God, a member of God's household or family. Accordingly, we are now heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And so the only way the benefits due to us as heirs of God could be released is if the testator died. And so this is another reason why our Lord and Savior died, my fellow believer. A testament only has value after the testator or the person who produced the last will and testament dies. In the church, we have been convinced that we will primarily experience benefits of our relationship with God after we die. But the Lord spoke a word to me some time ago. Here's what the Lord said to me. He said that as children and heirs of God, our ability to access benefits under our relationship with God has nothing to do with our death, but everything to do with Jesus' death. Again, as children and heirs of God, our ability to access benefits under our relationship with God has nothing to do with our death, but everything to do with Jesus' death. My brother and my sister, Christ Jesus has already died, and consequently, the inheritance or benefits due to God's children and his heirs under his will and testament have already been released. Because many of us do not realize that the inheritance was released, we continue to function as children, being bound by the systems of this world, and not as sons of God, experiencing the life and life more abundantly that Christ Jesus came to make available to us in God's kingdom or under God's government. With this in mind, what is the Bible all about? By its very nature, the Bible is a book about inheritance. Again, by its very nature, the Bible is a book about inheritance. And by the way, inheritance is not a religious matter, but a legal one. Again, inheritance is not a religious matter, but a legal one. Before we proceed, let's receive a simple or a better understanding of what a will is and what a testament is. Here it is. What is a will? A will is an outline of a person's wishes as to how his or her property is to be distributed upon his or her death. And what is a testament? Well, when the person documents and makes the details of his or her will known, it is called his or her testament. And so this basically outlines what a will is and what a testament is. So let's take a closer look or another look at our Bible. Notice we say here that we're speaking about a testament. When the person documents and makes the details of his or her will known, it is called his or her testament. So let's take a look at our Bible. What is our Bible separated into? The Bible is separated into two testaments. The Bible is separated into the Old Testament and the New Testament. And what is the natural benefit always provided by a testament? The benefit that becomes available under a testament is called an inheritance. And so the question is, what is the inheritance under the Old Testament and what is the inheritance under the New Testament? Let's discover what the inheritance is under the Old Testament first. Now, as you know, the promise was made to Father Abraham. And what exactly did God promise to Father Abraham? Well, here it is, as we begin to seek to understand or discover what the inheritance was under the Old Testament. God told Father Abraham, this is Genesis 12:1. Now the Lord said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will shew thee. Now Abraham did not fully obey God because he took Lot, his brother's son, with him, and he was part of his kindred. Notice in the highlighted portion of this scripture, God tell him to get away from your kindred. And so because Abram took Lot with him, he was not fully in compliance with God's instructions to him. But after he fully aligned himself with God's will by separating himself from Lot, then God started to outline his promise to Father Abraham. This is Genesis chapter 13, verses 14 to 17, as we seek to discover the inheritance under the Old Testament. The Bible says, and the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, he said, lift up now thine eyes, and look from the place where thou art northward, and southward, and eastward, and westward. Here it is in verse 15. He said, for all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. In verse 16, God told him, and I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. In verse 17, he said again, arise, walk through the land, in the length of it and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. After some years, God made another clear promise to Father Abraham. Here it is in Genesis chapter 15, verse 7. The Bible says, and he said unto him, this is God speaking to Abram now, he said, I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it. Remember what God told Moses generations later. Here it is, Deuteronomy chapter 3, verses 27 to 28, as we discover the inheritance under the Old Testament. God told him, "Get thee up into the top of Pisgah, and lift up thine eyes westward and northward and southward and eastward, and behold it with thine eyes, for thou shalt not go over this Jordan." In verse 28, God told him, "But charge Joshua, and encourage him, and strengthen him, for he shall go over before this people, and he shall cause them to inherit the land which thou shalt see." And so God told Moses that Joshua would cause the children of Israel, or descendants of Father Abraham, to inherit the land. Before we proceed, let's take a closer look at this word inherit that we have animated here. The word inherit is the Hebrew word yarash. That's Y-A-R-A-S-H. This means to occupy by driving out previous tenants and possessing in their place. This word inherit means to seize. It means to enjoy. It means to get, have, or take as a possession. And so this is what God wanted them to do with the land. In this regard, remember one of the first things that God said to Joshua after the death of brother Moses. This is Joshua chapter 1, verse 6. God told Joshua, "Be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them." And so, my fellow believer, land was the inheritance under the Old Testament. And so let's go back to our Bible. We said that the Bible is separated into two testaments, the Old Testament and the New Testament. We said that the natural benefit of a testament is an inheritance. And as we just saw from the Word of God, we discovered that land was the inheritance under the Old Testament. The only unknown then is the inheritance under the New Testament, of which we are a part. I want you to think about this, my fellow believer. We are part of the New Testament, and most of God's people don't know what their inheritance is under the New Testament or the New Covenant that we are now part of. In fact, many of us do not even have a revelation of the fact that we are heirs. And so again, we say that the only unknown on this slide is what is the inheritance under the New Testament. And so let's discover the major inheritance mentioned in the New Testament. We begin our discovery in the book of James. Here's what James said to us as we seek to discover what the major inheritance is in the New Testament. What is our inheritance under the New Testament? James said a thing here to us in James 2 and 5. James said, "Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him?" And so James lets us know that we are heirs of the kingdom. Here's a word that Jesus spoke to his disciples, including you and I. This is Luke chapter 22, verse 29. Jesus said, "And I appoint unto you a kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me." Notice we have this word "appoint" highlighted here. Let's take a closer look at this word "appoint" from our Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew dictionary. Now, this word "appoint" that Jesus mentioned in that scripture is the Greek word diathemi. It means to put apart. It means to assign. But most of all, this word "appoint" also means to bequeath. Notice Jesus said, "I appoint unto you a kingdom." And he was saying, "Listen, I bequeath unto you a kingdom as my Father hath bequeathed unto me." And so, my fellow believer, as you are no doubt aware, to bequeath means to direct or allocate the benefits due under a will and testament to the designated heirs. And so when Jesus said, "I appoint unto you a kingdom," he's saying, "I bequeath unto you a kingdom." And so this is what we've come to discover tonight, our inheritance under the New Testament. And so Christ Jesus in this scripture, he released the inheritance of the kingdom to his disciples, including you and I. Here's what Paul said to us through his letter to the Colossians. This is Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 to 13. Paul said a thing here in verse 12. He said, "Giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light." And so Paul lets us know that our God qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance. Then Paul went on to confirm what this inheritance is that we were made meet or qualified for. Here it is in verse 13 of Colossians 1. Paul said, "Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Notice Paul said that our God had made us meet to be partakers, or he qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Then in this scripture, he lets us know what this inheritance was. He said, who hath delivered us from the power or the domain or the kingdom of darkness, and our God hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. My fellow believer, our deliverance out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light or the kingdom of God is our inheritance. We were qualified or made meet to obtain this inheritance through our sonship and through our adoption in God's family. Here's what Paul said to us again through his letter to the church at Corinth. Again, we're seeking to discover, what is the inheritance under this New Testament that you and I are now part of? This is 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 to 10. Paul said, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? He said, be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. In verse 10, he said, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And so Paul is letting us know the major inheritance that became available to those of us who are under the New Testament. It is the kingdom of God. Here's Paul again in his letter to the Galatians. This is Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 to 21. Paul said, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness. He said here in verse 20, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. Here it is in verse 21. He said, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. He said, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Here's Paul one more time through his letter to the Ephesians. This is Ephesians chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. Paul said, but fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. In verse 4, Paul said, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. In verse 5 of Ephesians 5, Paul said, for this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. And so we begin to see a consistent theme here. There's one major inheritance mentioned in or under the New Testament. It is the inheritance of the kingdom of God. Here's Paul one last time through his letter to the Corinthians. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50. Paul said, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. And so, my fellow believer, as the kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom, it cannot be inherited by flesh and blood. Here's a glimpse of Jesus separating the sheep from the goats as he establishes the physical manifestation of the kingdom in the age to come. Again, here's a glimpse of Jesus separating the sheep from the goats as he establishes the physical manifestation of the kingdom in the age to come. Again, Jesus lets us know what our inheritance is under the New Testament. Here it is. This is Matthew chapter 25, verse 34. The Bible says, then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Now in this scripture, Jesus was referring to the physical manifestation of the kingdom to be inherited by the saints in the age to come after he returns. Now in the church, whenever we hear the words kingdom of God, we have been conditioned to automatically think about the heaven that we hope to go to when we die. We acknowledge that in this scripture, when Jesus refers to those on his right hand and let them know that they could come because they are blessed of his Father, and then he said that they could come and inherit the kingdom prepared for them from the foundation of the world, Jesus was here speaking about the physical manifestation of the kingdom to be experienced after we die. And again, we say in the church, we have a tendency, whenever we hear the words kingdom of God, we have been conditioned to think about the heaven that we hope to go to when we die. Indeed, there are a few scriptures where Jesus was referring to the New Jerusalem or the kingdom to be experienced after we die, as in this scripture. However, the kingdom of God that Jesus and his disciples primarily preached and taught about is not the heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die. Here's what Jesus said to his disciples. This is Mark chapter 9, verse 1. Look at what Jesus said here. The Bible says, "And he said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power." Again, Jesus said, "Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power." Notice Jesus is saying here that the kingdom of God was to be experienced by some of them standing there before they died. And so, of course, this kingdom of God that Jesus was speaking about here is not the same kingdom of God that we just looked at in St. Matthew chapter 25, verse 34. Jesus was referring here to the day of Pentecost, when God would begin to actively govern and influence his people from the inside by his Holy Spirit, who is called the earnest of our inheritance, whereby we as the saints of God would be empowered firstly to reflect the culture and values of the kingdom, and then to demonstrate the power and authority of the kingdom. Jesus said that there were some standing here which would not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. Jesus was speaking about the day of Pentecost, my fellow believer. Here's what Paul the Apostle said about the kingdom, again letting us know that the kingdom of God that the apostles and Jesus spoke about is not the heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die. This is Romans chapter 14, verse 17. Paul said, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost." Paul again spoke about the kingdom in his first letter to the Corinthians. Here it is. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 19 to 20. Paul said, "But I will come to you shortly, if the Lord will, and will know not the speech of them which are puffed up, but the power." Look at what Paul said here in verse 20. Paul said, "For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power." My fellow believer, the kingdom of God provides power to cause the influence, culture, and authority of the kingdom of heaven to be experienced on the earth. We as the saints of God have also inherited this kingdom. We have also inherited this power, firstly, to manifest the nature and the character of the King of Heaven and the culture of the Kingdom of Heaven and the power of the Kingdom of Heaven. And so because of our sonship and the fact that we have inherited this kingdom, we also have access to the rights, privileges, benefits, and authority of the Kingdom of Heaven. This is why Jesus said to us, this is Matthew chapter 16, verse 19. He said, "And I will give unto thee," what? "The keys of the Kingdom of Heaven." And he said, as a result of us possessing these keys or receiving these keys, he said, "And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." My fellow believer, this is a wonderful promise from Christ Jesus that very few of us in the church have tapped into. Notice Jesus is saying that the keys of the kingdom are to be utilized on the earth. He said, "And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." And so again, our access to the resources from the kingdom of heaven through these keys that Christ Jesus has made available to us has nothing to do with our death, because it is expected that we would influence the earth with the power and the authority of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus is saying that the keys of the kingdom are to be utilized on the earth to cause the influence of heaven to be experienced on the earth. Again, we say the kingdom of God is not the heaven that we hope to go to after we die. Here again is what Christ Jesus said to the 70 apostles as he sent them out in Luke chapter 10. This is Luke chapter 10, verses 8 to 9. "And into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you, eat such things as are set before you." Look at verse 9. "He told them, and heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you." Notice what Jesus said. Jesus told them to heal the sick that are therein, and after you've already healed the sick, he said, "Let the people know that they were healed." Why? "Because the kingdom of God hath come nigh," or "come near unto them." Jesus told the 70 apostles to let people know that when they received their healing, it was as a result of the presence and operation of the kingdom of God and the consequent manifestation of the culture of the kingdom of God, the culture of healing from the kingdom of heaven. Now in Matthew chapter 12, verse 24, The Pharisees accused Jesus of casting out devils by Beelzebub. What did Jesus say to them to also confirm that the kingdom of God that we inherited, the kingdom of God that Jesus and his disciples primarily taught and preached about, is not only the heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die? But here's what Jesus said to the Pharisees after they accused him of casting out devils by Beelzebub. Jesus told those Pharisees, "If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you." And so, my fellow believer, as he was casting out devils, Jesus let them know that he was demonstrating that a more powerful kingdom had come to override, supersede, and exercise dominion over the kingdom of darkness. Again, Jesus told the Pharisees, "If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you." And so Jesus is here again confirming that this kingdom that he was focusing on is not just the kingdom or heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die. Jesus said, "If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you." My fellow believer, this is the same kingdom power that we received as part of our inheritance because we are now believers and sons of God. Here's an exchange that Christ Jesus had with the Pharisees about the timing and manifestation of the kingdom of God, which again confirms that the kingdom of God that he and his disciples primarily taught and preached about is not the heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die. This is Luke chapter 17, verses 20 to 21. The Bible says, "And when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, 'The kingdom of God cometh not with observation.'" Look at verse 21 of Luke 17. Jesus told those Pharisees, "Neither shall they say, 'Lo here,' or 'Lo there,' for behold, the kingdom of God is within you." And so, my fellow believer, this kingdom that we inherited is not just the heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die. As we saw in Matthew 25, 34, we inherited the kingdom of God that we have access to right here and right now. This is the primary benefit that became due to us, or that we inherited under the New Testament of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "Neither shall they say, 'Lo here,' or 'Lo there,' for behold, the kingdom of God is within you." God's Spirit on the inside of us represents the presence of the King of Heaven. And wherever a king is, so is his sovereign power, governing influence, and the authority of his kingdom. The kingdom of God is now within us, and the kingdom of God is also in our midst, and the kingdom of God is among us. This is why we are now, right now, able to experience the rights and privileges and benefits and the culture of the kingdom of heaven, the culture of healing, the culture of abundant provision, the culture of deliverance, the culture of peace and joy and strength for our trials. Jesus told the Pharisees that the kingdom of God is within you. This word "within" also means among you or in your midst. And so Jesus is letting us know that because we are sons of God, citizens of his heavenly kingdom, we are now heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. We inherited the kingdom of God. Remember, he said, "I bequeath unto you a kingdom." And so we praise God that the kingdom has been allocated to us as part of our inheritance. And so right now we have access to the rights, privileges, benefits, power, and authority of the kingdom. This is not just about the heaven that we hope to go to one day when we die. What then is this kingdom of God that we received as part of our inheritance under the New Testament? Well, firstly, let's remember what the word "kingdom" means from our Strong's Concordance with Greek and Hebrew dictionary. The word "kingdom" is the Greek word basileia. That's B-A-S-I-L-E-I-A. Now, this means royal power. It means royalty, kingship, reign, dominion. It means the right and authority to rule over a domain or territory. This is what you inherited now. You inherited the kingdom. You inherited royal power. You inherited royalty. You inherited kingship, the ability to reign. You inherited dominion. Remember, in the beginning, Genesis 1:26, the first gift that God gave to us was dominion. God said, "Let us make man in our image after our likeness and let them have dominion." But we learned that the gifts and calling of God are without repentance, or they are irrevocable. Because Christ Jesus came to seek and to save, he came to recover and to restore that which was lost. Christ Jesus restored to us everything that Adam and Eve lost Adam and Eve had dominion in the beginning. And so because of the completion of Jesus' mission, including his death on the cross and consequent defeat of the devil and our redemption and deliverance from the kingdom of darkness, Christ Jesus has broken the curse of us and he has restored to us everything that Adam and Eve lost. One of the major things that Adam and Eve lost was the ability to fulfill their dominion mandate on the earth. And so we inherited the kingdom. Again, kingdom is the Greek word basileia, B-A-S-I-L-E-I-A, which means royal power. It means royalty, kingship, reign, dominion. It also means the right and authority to rule over a domain or a territory. Remember also what kingdom means, as described by Brother Tom Casey in his book called Studies in the Kingdom of God. Brother Casey said, kingdom is the sovereignty and authority one possesses, which enables him or her to rule. Brother Casey said, kingdom is the sovereignty and authority one possesses, which enables him or her to rule. This is what you inherited, my fellow believer. We now possess the kingdom. We have inherited the kingdom. We have inherited the sovereignty and authority, which enables us to rule under the delegated authority of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the same dominion that Adam and Eve had in the beginning. Remember Micah chapter 4, verse 8. Micah said, and thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion. Micah said, unto you shall come, unto thee shall come even the first dominion. The kingdom shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem. And so we praise God that the first dominion has been restored to us. This is part of the rights, privileges, and benefits that we are now entitled to by virtue of our sonship, by virtue of the fact that we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. You, my fellow believer, inherited the kingdom. So what then is this kingdom that Jesus and his disciples primarily preached and taught about? Well, here it is. The kingdom of God is the governing influence and sovereign rulership of God within and upon our lives, which was made possible by the death of Christ Jesus and our acceptance of his plan of salvation through faith, whereby we were equipped with God's Holy Spirit, who empowers us to reflect the morals, values, standards, lifestyle, character, and nature of the King of Heaven, and the culture, power, and authority of God's kingdom, and experience the supernatural, beneficial, and advantageous quality of life in God's kingdom or under God's government. The kingdom of God is the governing influence and sovereign rulership of God within and upon our lives, which was made possible by the death of Christ Jesus and our acceptance of his plan of salvation through faith, whereby we were equipped with God's Holy Spirit, who empowers us to reflect the morals, values, standards, lifestyle, character, and nature of the King of Heaven, and the culture, power, and authority of God's kingdom. And we are now able to experience the supernatural, beneficial, and advantageous quality of life in God's kingdom or under God's government. Remember, Jesus said to us in St. John chapter 10, verse 10, that he came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Jesus' work and ministry was all about making life on another level accessible and available to the people of God. This is why we say here that we are now able to experience the supernatural, beneficial, and advantageous quality of life in God's kingdom or under God's government. This, my brother and my sister, again we say, is life and life more abundantly. And so we've concluded what our inheritance is under the New Testament. And so let's revert to our Bibles. What do we see in our Bibles? Let me say that the Bible is separated into two testaments, the Old Testament and the New Testament. We said that the natural benefit of a testament is an inheritance. Remember, we learned that the inheritance under the Old Testament is land, and we just discovered from the Word of God that the inheritance under the New Testament is the kingdom of God. And so our inheritance under the New Testament is the kingdom of God, my fellow believer. And so we praise our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for this wonderful revelation. Remember again what Jesus said about his Father's willingness to give us the kingdom. You know, Jesus said, listen, man, your Father, he's excited to give you the kingdom. But here's where Jesus confirms this for us. This is Luke chapter 12, verse 32. Jesus said, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Again, Jesus said, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. because the Father gave us the kingdom. As believers, we inherited the kingdom of God, and we now possess the kingdom. Again, because the Father gave us the kingdom, as believers, we inherited the kingdom of God, and right now, the saints of God now possess the kingdom. And this is the word that the Lord would have us to release to the people of God. We've been sharing on this even from the previous message. Now the Lord would have us to reiterate this to the people of God tonight, to let them know, to let us all know that we are sons of God. We are now heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And the primary inheritance under the New Testament is the kingdom of God. Jesus said, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Our Father takes great pleasure in giving us the kingdom. And because he gave us the kingdom, we now possess the kingdom. But remember what we said it means to possess the kingdom. It's one thing to know that we possess the kingdom, but if we don't understand what it means to possess the kingdom, then our possession of the kingdom really means nothing. But here's what it means to possess the kingdom. Possessing the kingdom means ownership of the legal and legitimate right, power, and authority to reign or exercise dominion, rulership, and governing influence over a designated territory or domain. Again, possessing the kingdom means ownership of the legal and legitimate right, power, and authority to reign or exercise dominion, rulership, and governing influence over a designated territory or domain. Even now, I'm reminded of what Paul said to us. Paul said that because we have received the abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness, we are now able to reign in life by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so we praise God that we now possess the kingdom. Remember what we said at the beginning of this message. I said that I believe that one of the greatest mysteries in the church is a revelation about the kingdom of God, including the fact that as a result of the finished work of Calvary and the subsequent release of God's Holy Spirit, the body of Christ now possesses the kingdom and can manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom right here and right now. Again, I believe that one of the greatest mysteries in the church is a revelation about the kingdom of God, including the fact that as a result of the finished work of Calvary and the subsequent release of God's Holy Spirit, the body of Christ now possesses the kingdom and can manifest the culture, power, and authority of the kingdom right here and right now. And so as we close tonight, remember what Brother Tom Casey said about the need for believers to discover the mystery of the kingdom of God. Here's what Brother Tom Casey said to us as we prepare to close tonight. Brother Casey said, "We can't fully grasp and accomplish our purpose on the earth as human beings and as followers of Jesus without a clear understanding and first-hand experience of the reality of the presence of the kingdom of God and its activities in our lives." Again, Brother Casey lets us know that we can't fully grasp and accomplish our purpose on the earth as human beings and as followers of Jesus without a clear understanding and first-hand experience of the reality of the presence of the kingdom of God and its activities in our lives. And so this, my fellow believer, is why we need to rediscover the believer's New Testament inheritance of the kingdom of heaven. Again, this is why we all need to rediscover the believer's New Testament inheritance of the kingdom of heaven. And so again, we praise God for this wonderful night. We thank God so much for each and every one of you that have taken time from your busy schedule and tuned in to tonight's Bible study. Again, we want to let you know how much we enjoy sharing this word, this wonderful gospel of the kingdom with the people of God. We thank God so much for you. We do believe that this is the dispensation where our God is revealing the mysteries of the kingdom to his people. And so again, we thank you so much for joining us in tonight's Bible study as we sought to rediscover the believer's New Testament inheritance of the kingdom of heaven. Again, we say, imagine that we are now part of the New Testament, but many of us in the body of Christ are not aware of the inheritance that fell due to us or came due to us under this New Testament that we are now part of. And so we praise God for you. Let's just bow in a word of prayer as we close out tonight. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, we thank you so much for what our ears have heard and what our hearts have received this night. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you that your word declares, my Father, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Christ Jesus declared that if we continue in his word, then are we his disciples indeed, and we shall know the truth, and the truth that we know shall make us free. Father God, we believe, Lord God, that someone has been set free by this word tonight, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father God, we thank you that Paul the Apostle lets us know that we will only be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord, that even after this night, someone's mind is being renewed. Father God, even now, my Father, to receive a revelation of the fact that we are now heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And so, Father God, we begin to praise you, my Father God, because we are heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. We have received the inheritance of the kingdom of God, and we have access to this kingdom both now and throughout eternity. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, that in a greater way, my Father God, in Jesus' name, we will begin to walk in the rights, privileges, and benefits that became available to us as heirs of God, my Father God, as heirs of the kingdom of heaven. Father God, we just bless you. We glorify you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Again, Holy Father, we seal this word in the hearts and the minds of the people of God. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that after this night, Father God, we shall never be the same again. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we praise you because we believe, oh God, that somebody is being strengthened with all might, Father God, even now in the inner man. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Father, Lord God, we do believe. Unfortunately, in the body of Christ, we have been operating, Lord, on such a lower level than you expect, my Father God, for such a long time. And Father God, it's primarily because we see ourselves as being part of a religion, my Father, with a primary focus on us, Lord God, being prepared to go to heaven when we die. But we praise you, Father God, that Christ Jesus has bequeathed unto us the kingdom. We praise you, Holy Father, that Christ Jesus said that this kingdom, Lord God, was to be experienced and is to be experienced before we die. We praise you, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, that Christ Jesus said, neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within us. We praise you, Father God, that Paul the Apostle said that the kingdom of God is not in word, but in dunamis, but in power, my Father. And so because the kingdom of God is within us, my Father, and the kingdom of God is power, Father God, we praise you that the dunamis and the power of God is now within us, my Father. The kingdom of God is among us, O God, in Jesus' name. And right now, Lord God, we are able to experience the culture of power and the authority and the benefits and the rights and the privileges. And we now have access to resources from your heavenly kingdom, my Father. We inherited the kingdom, my Father, for Christ Jesus himself declared, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord God, because, Father God, we understand now that it is your good pleasure to give us the kingdom. And so, Father God, we willingly take, Father God, and accept this kingdom, my Father. But help us, Lord God, to appropriate the rights, privileges, and benefits that became available to us by virtue of our inheritance of the kingdom of God. Father God, again, Father, we thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We begin to release kingdom power and authority every place that this word is reaching this night. We thank you again, Father God, that hearts and minds are being transformed. We believe that you're doing a mighty work in the body of Christ, my Father. Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, you're giving us a great and a mighty revelation of the kingdom of God, because Christ Jesus himself declared that it's given unto us to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And so, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord God, in Jesus' name, that by the power and presence and work of Holy Spirit, my Father, we are receiving knowledge and revelation about the mysteries of the kingdom of God right here and right now. And so, Father God, we just bless you, Lord. We glorify and extol you, Lord God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For Lord God, there's none like you, Father, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father God, we just bless you, Lord God, and we praise you, Father, in Jesus' name. Even now, Lord God, we begin to lift up our loved ones, Father, people we know, people that we don't know, my Father, that might not be children of God, heirs of your heavenly kingdom and citizens of God. Father God, we begin to pray, my Father God, as we lift up, Lord God, our loved ones, my Father, those we know, those we don't know, my Father God. We know, Father, that your word declares that you are not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so, Father God, we begin to pray even now that you turn their hearts toward you, my Father. Even now, Lord God, by the power vested in us as ambassadors for Christ, as plenipotentiaries, diplomats, and envoys of your heavenly kingdom, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we begin to take authority over every spirit that would seek to hold those individuals captive in the kingdom of darkness, my Father. Lord God, we begin to declare that they are loosed, Father God. They are released, my Father God, from the kingdom of darkness, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. Again, thank you for turning hearts toward you. For your word declares that the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. You are the one who are able to turn the king's heart whithersoever you will. And so we thank you for turning hearts toward you, Father God, even now. Father God, we just bless you and glorify you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Father. For Lord God, we know, Lord God, that that it is your will, my Father, that all men would be delivered from the kingdom of darkness and translated into the kingdom of your dear Son. And so, Father God, we praise you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus, for the wonderful revelation, my Father, that, Lord God, we have received power, we have received exousia to become the sons of God. We praise you, Lord God, that in every dispensation, my Father, you are seeking to raise up a people of inheritance. And so, Lord God, even as land was the inheritance under the Old Testament, we praise you, Lord God, that you've shown us from the word of God this night that the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven, is the inheritance under the New Testament. We praise you, Lord God, that you're helping us to rediscover our, Father God, New Testament inheritance of the kingdom of God, my Father. Lord God, we do believe, oh God, that Christ Jesus said that the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy, but Jesus came so that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And so, Father God, we begin to pray, my Father God, that each and every one of us, Lord God, the sons of God, the saints of God, the citizens of the heavenly kingdom, the possessors of the kingdom, the inheritors of the kingdom, Father God, that we begin to live life on that supernatural level, my Father, that in a greater way, Lord God, we begin to experience, Lord God, the Father God, the benefits, Lord God, rights and privileges of life in your kingdom, or life under your government. And so, Lord God, we begin to glorify you, Lord God. We extol you, my Father God, and magnify you, Lord God. You're our strength and our song, our shield and buckler, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And we just begin to glorify you right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Father God, we just begin to honor you, Lord God, even now, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, and bless your holy precious name. Even now, Lord God, we begin to lift up the people of God, my Father. Perhaps someone has some ailment, Lord God, some symptoms, Lord God, of some sickness, some disease in their bodies. Father God, we begin to stand in the gap and make up the hedge for the people of God even now. Lord God, we begin to declare that the kingdom of God is coming to the people of God. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, because Christ Jesus told the 70 apostles to heal the sick as they went out and let them know that the kingdom of God has come unto them. And so, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, my Father, we begin to declare, Lord God, even now, that the kingdom of God has come nigh unto the people of God, my Father. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, that healing is the children's bread, my Father. We thank you, Lord God, that healing is part of the kingdom welfare program to which we are entitled as citizens of your heavenly kingdom. Father God, we praise you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus. For Lord God, you let us know that the Bible is the constitution of the kingdom of heaven. And in our constitution, my Father, Lord God, in Exodus chapter 23, verse 25, Lord God, your word declares that because we serve you, Lord God, you promised to bless our bread and our water, and you promised to take sickness and disease from the midst of us. And so, Lord God, we thank you, my Father, that even now, my Father, sickness and disease, Lord God, are being removed from the bodies of the people of God even now. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, again, we take authority over every spirit of infirmity, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. The word of God declares that even as Jesus sent out his disciples to preach the gospel of the kingdom, the Bible teaches us, Lord God, in Mark chapter 16, verse 20, that the disciples went everywhere preaching the word of God, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. And so, Father God, we thank you even now, Lord God, for confirming the word, Lord God, the word of the kingdom. Father God, we begin to declare that the kingdom of God is here. Again, Jesus said, Lord God, neither shall they say, lo here or lo there. For behold, the kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of God is among you. And so, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for confirming the word. We thank you for confirming our declaration of the kingdom's arrival, presence, and operation, my Father, in our midst, by manifesting the culture, power, and authority of your kingdom. We drive every spirit of infirmity from the bodies of the people of God in Jesus' name. Again, we declare the kingdom of God has come, Father God, unto the people of God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we begin to declare healing and wholeness from the crowns of their head to the soles of their feet, my Father. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, that kingdom is about government, my Father, and government is about divine order. And so, Lord God, we call for your divine order in the bodies of the people of God. We begin to declare, Lord God, that everything that is out of order is set in order right now. We say the kingdom of God has come. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that the centurion sent a message to Jesus. He told him, there's no need for you to come to my house. All you have to do is say in a word and my servant shall be healed. And so, Father God, we thank you that Christ Jesus told us that because we believe on him, the works that he did shall we do also, and even greater works shall we do, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And so, because Jesus Christ was able to say in a word, my Father, and heal that centurion servant, we begin to say in a word even now, my Father God, we do not have to come to people's house tonight. We don't have to go to people's house tonight. We begin to speak, Lord God, the word of the kingdom, my Father. Lord God, manifest the power and the culture, Father God, and the authority of your kingdom by removing every spirit of infirmity from the bodies of the people of God even now. Father God, we give you praise and glory and honor. We thank you, Lord God, that your word declares, oh God, that you shall supply all of our need according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Someone needs healing right now, my Father. And so we're thank you, Lord God, for supplying the need of healing. Somebody needs a financial breakthrough. We thank you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus for providing, Lord God, that financial breakthrough. Somebody needs peace, my Father God. Somebody needs, Lord God, to be comforted, Lord God. Somebody's going through an hour of bereavement, my Father. Holy Spirit is the comforter. We thank you for comforting hearts and minds, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, somebody needs, Lord God, joy, Father God. Somebody needs their loved one to be born again, Father. Somebody needs peace in their homes, Lord God. Somebody needs home. Father God, we thank you, Lord God. That's a married couple, my Father. They're believing you for a child, my Father God. We speak life and strength, Lord God. Father God, and divine order in that womb, Father God, in his body or her body, Father God, wherever the issues are. We thank you, Lord God, that they will, right now, we begin to prophesy over them and call forth that holy seed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we give you glory and honor, might and dominion and power. We begin to lift up, Lord God, the seed of the people of God, the little children, my Father. We begin to prophesy over them, my Father, for we see an all-out attack. Lord God, Father God, in an effort, Lord God, to sexualize, my Father God, the young people, my Father. That spirit is prevalent in the United States of America, my Father. But Lord God, we begin to insulate and protect and preserve the hearts and minds of our people even now, Lord God. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, my Father, we begin to prophesy over the young people even now, over the little children, my Father. We declare, Lord God, that your will, purpose, and intent shall be fulfilled and realized, Lord God, in their lives. We begin to declare by faith, Lord God, that the devil shall not abort the plans and the purposes that you, Holy Father God, have established for those young people, for those little children. We thank you, Lord God, that no weapon that is formed against us or the young children shall prosper. We thank you, Lord, for frustrating every plan, every work of the devil. Father God, we see, Lord God, the members of the LGBTQ plus community singing and chanting in the streets. We are here, we are queer, and we're coming for the children. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for insulating and protecting, Father God, the young people, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. For we know, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, that Jesus came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And so again, Father, we say the kingdom of God has come unto those young people, unto the little children, my Father, unto the holy seed, my Father. We thank you that David declared that he was young and then old, but he's never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging bread. And so we thank you, my Father, for going before those young people, Father God, before those children, Lord God, and making every crooked path straight, my Father. Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, perfecting everything concerning them, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, perfecting your will, purpose, and intent in their lives. Again, Father, we thank you, Lord. Father God, we seal the healing of the people of God even now in the name of Jesus Christ. Father God, we just give you glory and honor, might and dominion and power. And Lord God, again, we thank you, my Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, for this night helping us to rediscover, Father God, the New Testament provision, Father God, and inheritance of the kingdom of heaven for the people of God. Father, we just appreciate God so much, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. We appreciate you so much for all that you continue to do, all that you continue to reveal to the people of God. Father, we thank you, and we say in Jesus' name, we say again, the kingdom of God has come, and we say amen and amen. Bless the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
You've been listening to a message by Pastor Aziel McFaul, Kingdom citizen and ambassador of Christ. We trust that this message has been a blessing to you and that in some small way it has helped you to become more knowledgeable about God's kingdom and his righteousness. It is our prayer that God grants you a heart that hungers and thirsts after his kingdom and his righteousness so that you will be filled or supplied and begin to experience the abundant life that Christ Jesus came to make available to his children. If you desire further information about our ministry or access to additional resources, please feel free to contact Pastor McFaul at 242-427-5512 or internationally at 954-284-7909. Dare to take God at his word. Seek his kingdom and his righteousness. Be delivered from the spirit of religion and begin to live life on another level. God bless you is our prayer.
Let the kings worship him today. Let the kings worship him.